join our voices here and baptize into your name most holy on the front of our handout. God bless your worship. Gave to you in your baptism?
Yes, I do.
Do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways?
Yes, I renounce him.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty?
Yes, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son?
Yes, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
Yes, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church.
us to continue steadfast in this faith and in the promise of your baptism as a member of Christ's church. Will you be diligent in your use of God's word and his sacramental feast?
Yes, with the help of God.
You must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit and has forgiven you all your sin, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting.
Amen.
Isaiah, about 700 years before Jesus, and already Isaiah is looking forward to the gift that God has for you and me in water.
The Old Testament reading comes from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1 through 7. But now, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel.
Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.
When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you.
When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned.
And the flame shall not consume you.
For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior.
I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Sheba in exchange for you, because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you. I give men in return for you, people in exchange for your life.
Fear not, for I am with you.
I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I was there to hear your glory.
And we hear from St. Paul as he tells us about the beautiful gift that God has for us in our baptism.
So our New Testament reading is from Romans chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound?
By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized are in Jesus? For baptized into death.
We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his.
We know that our old self was crucified with him, in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin.
For one who has died has been set free from sin.
Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him.
For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And thank God. So let's stand as we hear the story of Jesus himself coming to the water, opening for us that flood of forgiveness. Thank you, Jesus.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the third chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
People's hopes were rising as they all wondered whether John was the Messiah. John replied to all of them, "I baptize you with water, but the one who's more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie his sandal straps. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing shovel is in his hand to clean up his threshing floor. He will gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn the husks in a fire that can never be put out." With many other encouraging words, he told the good news to the people. John spoke out against the ruler Herod, because Herod had married his own sister-in-law, Herodias. He also spoke out against Herod for all the evil things he had done. So Herod added one more evil to all the others. He locked John in prison. When all the people were baptized, Jesus too was baptized. While he was praying, heaven opened, and the Holy Spirit came down to him in the form of a dove. A voice from heaven said,
"You are my son, whom I love. I am pleased with you."
This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The bottom of page 5, what is baptism? Baptism is not just plain water,
but it is water included in God's command and combined with God's word.
What is this word from God? Christ
our Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit."
What benefits does baptism give?
It works forgiveness of sins, rescues from death of the devil,
and gives eternal salvation to all who believe in this.
Which are these words and promises of God?
Christ our Lord says in the last chapter of Mark, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned."
How can water do such great things?
Certainly not just water, but the word of God in and with the water does these things.
Along with the faith which trusts this word.
without God's word, that water is plain water and no baptism.
But with the word of God, it is a baptism.
That is a life-giving water, rich in grace.
And the washing of a new birth in the Holy Spirit.
As St. Paul says in Titus chapter 3,
he saved us from our washing of new birth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously.
What does such baptizing with water indicate?
It indicates that the old Adam in us is truly
abdicated and repentant, he's drowned from God, all sins and evil desires,
and that a new man should daily emerge in our eyes to live before God in righteousness and purity forever.
Where is this written?
St. Paul writes in Romans chapter 6, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death,
in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead, the glory of the Father, we too may live in our life.
Jesus baptized us. Paul reminds us how we were there
washed and in fact even buried with Christ in baptism, that sin dying in us so that we can rise to new life this day and forever. So I've preached on these texts a few times, and this time I'm going to turn instead to Isaiah, because it astounds me as I look at it. Here we are 700 years before Jesus is baptized, and already Isaiah starts talking about the great gift. It's not even his own words, Isaiah, but he says, "These are the words from the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not." The most common command across the scripture, Old and New Testament, fear not. Why is God always telling us not to be scared? Fear not. Anybody here especially afraid? I don't think of myself as a fearful person. Fear not. Fear not. Fear not. And yet, honestly, when I step back in the quiet sometimes, I find this a tremendously scary world sometimes. I can feel the heat of the spiritual enemy. Not just tempting, but also throwing in my face the wickedness I have done. What especially scares me is the wickedness I sense within me. My own twist. I've got to ask you, when God says, "I created you, I formed you," how's it going? Are you living the life that God created you to live? Did not he form you to love? How you doing? Isn't it scary to see how far we are from the love, the holiness of our God? We who get so fearful and doubt his care for us and get selfish and wicked. And so I need Isaiah to be saying to me, fear not, because he who created you and formed you is the same who redeemed you. He paid the price so that your guilt does not stick to you. It's gone. Because who paid the price? You know his name. And not only did he pay the price for the whole world, but individually, he called you by name. I can tell you the day that Jesus said, "Stephen Earle," to me, "You are mine." Baby, it was April 13, 1958. I was 2 weeks old when the Father who created me, the Son who redeemed me, poured out the gift of baptism, and the Holy Spirit called me by name. Isn't that amazing? 700 years before Jesus, he's talking baptism. Fear not. God is for you. He knows you need him. When you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. Through the rivers, they will not overwhelm you. We should remember that originally these words, you know, are spoken not to us Christian people, but to Jacob's old people. He's the one renamed Israel. When were those people called through the water? Remember their origin story. Isaiah 700 years before Jesus, but 700 years before Isaiah, you go back to the day of their great leader Moses. God's people in bondage and slavery, they cannot free themselves, but God says, "Free, go," and they run. And they get to the Red Sea, and Egypt changes mind and chases them, hunts them down. This vast army come to slaughter them on the beach. What did God do? The enemy behind, the water in front. Moses lifts his staff, and the water opens. Imagine water piled up on the right, water piled up on the left. What are you going to do? Are you going to get slaughtered on the beach? Where are you going to go? God says, fear not. I'm leading the way. Fear not be overwhelmed, your enemy will. Go! He leads his people through the fire. Remember God leading them like a tornado, lit up with fire. His holy presence leading them to Mount Sinai, where they see the fire falling. This holy cloud, this lightning, and this fire falling. Moses goes up, and he doesn't come back for 40 days. They think we'll never see him again. Because this fiery God up there reveals his heart to Moses. These wonderful commands, these wonderful promises, 10, you shall love the Lord with everything you got. You shall love. Fiery, hot love, a love from the Spirit. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Fire, in fact, that does not burn us, but cleanses us and leads us to freedom. For look at this. Here comes three again. 1, 2, 3, the name of God. For I am the I am your God. Remember, God said to Moses, come, and Moses said, who are you? And God said, I am who I am. And whenever we get to the I am, the name of God in Scripture, in the English, we follow the old tradition, we just say the Lord. So if you read in the Hebrew, it says, for I am the I am, your God, you know me, Moses God, I gave you my name, the Holy One, not here come to scorch sinners, but to make you holy, for I am your Savior. The Hebrew word there is Yeshua. I am your Yeshua. Put it in plain English, I am your Jesus. Baptized into Christ. It changes our story. He will lead us through any possible trouble. So God promises, I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba. Cush is... So if you're on the map of Africa, you see Egypt and the Nile water waters that land. If you keep going south or up the Nile River, the next country you get to is Sudan. And if you keep going up to the very roots of the Nile River, you get to Seba. We call it Ethiopia. This vast land, this empire that had enslaved God's people, this wicked, cruel people who said, we will rule over Israel. And God said, they don't belong to you. These are my people. Even the poetry here is so beautiful. There's a ransom, there's an exchange, there's a return, there's an exchange. Why? Again, 1, 2, 3, right there in the middle. You're precious. Sometimes I look at our lives, and it doesn't look like that. Many of us are here at church Thursday grieving and giving God thanks for Alice. And here with us was Norma Remke. And Ruth drove her home, and then that night, you know, Norma sat down with a glass of wine and was working on her fingernails, and she didn't get up again. What? I mean, these most precious saints of God. Are we just common as dirt? God says, no! No way! To me, you are precious. You are honored. And yet sometimes, Lord, I feel such shame. I doubt what you're doing. I feel shame when I look at the way I haven't believed and lived. And he says, no! You are precious. I have honored you. For I love you. And I say, why? Why? You see, it's the same old story. God could give all of the old Egyptian empire, he could give all all the sinners in the world, and it wouldn't pay for my wrong. He's got a different plan. Fear not, he says, I am with you. Who? It is Jesus that becomes our ransom. He's the one exchanging places with us, taking my sin and guilt and death and rising up with new life for Alice and for Norma and for you and me. He promises, because I love you. You bet. God so loved the what? World that he gave his son. But here he gets personal. By the way, if God loves the whole world, does that include you? Aren't you kind of part of the world? And yet that's not enough for him. He wants you to know, I love you individually. And it's in that beautiful three-in-one water. I was startled when one of the Bible scholars reminded me that this is the only place in the Bible, old or new, Hebrew and Greek, that we actually have those three words in that exact order. I love you. Indeed, God loved the whole world. You can't hardly find a page of the Bible that doesn't talk about God's amazing, astounding love for his sinful creation. Here he says it so plain. He says it to you individually. I love you. Fear not. I love you so much, I'm not going to even leave you alone. There will be hundreds and millions coming to you from the east, from the west, from the north, from the south. Nothing can hold them back. Nothing can make them stay away and give up. They've got to give up to me. For these, says God, are my sons. My daughter, indeed, God so loved everyone. And in case you didn't get it yet, 1, 2, 3. I called you. I created you. I formed you. You're mine. I want to tell you one story this morning, one of my favorites, about St. Patrick, the patron saint of Ireland, right? So Patrick must be Irish, right? No. So here's the deal. Patrick is English. It's about the year 400. In the year 300, Constantine, after 300, was the first of the emperors to become a Christian, and the faith spread across that whole vast Roman Empire, all the way up to the very fringes there in Britain, in England. Patrick's father was a priest. But this young man was not so sure about his father's faith. He was working as a shepherd on the coast of, I don't know if it was Wales or Britain, when these fierce tribesmen, these non-Christians, these pagan warriors out of Ireland, these Celts, came and kidnapped the 16-year-old, dragged him away from everything he had ever known, and made him a slave, finally caring for their sheep and pigs on the coast of Ireland. And the young man finally cried out to his father and mother's God. Why? And in a dream, Patrick's memoir tells us, he heard the Lord say to him, tomorrow you shall flee. And he saw a fishing boat there, and he begged the fishermen, and they took him to France, where he studied himself to become a priest and ordained. Where did he want to go? Home? No. That's why they love him in Ireland. He went right back and said, you lousy, tough Irish, you enslaved me. I know a God who's tougher than you. I know a God who's so tough, he can forgive you. A God who loves you. And Patrick would go into great detail about how Jesus suffered, how he took the Father's wrath upon himself. He went through hell for us. how the world opposed him, but Jesus didn't care. He was going to do the right thing. He was going to love people. How even physically, Jesus was tortured, stripped, and mocked, and nailed. And sure enough, as Irish went up and down, all these fierce tribes, it's like, you know, kind of like Native America, all these people are killing each other there in Ireland. These fierce little tribes. One by one, like dominoes, they're falling to the love of Jesus. There's this one chieftain, this King Agnes, who seems to be the toughest of the tough. Until he hears, Agnes does, from Patrick about that fierce, fierce love of Jesus. And finally, this king's heart melts too. And he consents to have Patrick baptize him. And Patrick takes this warrior king down into the river, and feeling the sand under his feet and the strong stream, old Patrick is afraid that he's going to get knocked over before he can do this baptism. So he takes his shepherd's staff and he plants it there in the bed of the river, only to feel something go crunch. And he looks, and there is blood in the water. He looks at the chieftain's face, and he's standing there stoically, this tough man, but Patrick realizes he has just plunged his shepherd's staff through the chief's foot. Patrick figures, well, I'm a dead man anyway, I may as well finish the baptism. So, Chief Angus, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I baptize you. Child of God, I welcome you into the family, and I am so sorry that I put my staff through your foot. And the chieftain is startled. And he says, well, you told me how Jesus was impaled. I thought that was part of the ritual. Or at least that's the legend that I'm telling you in Ireland today. This is artwork by American Daniel Bunnell, B-O-N-N-E-L-L, and I just love this picture of Jesus' baptism. Because you see very clearly there the water and the fiery spirit that red, and the likeness of the holiness and the light that's shining, the spirit falling, and Jesus. The dove falling, you can hear that voice booming in the whiteness. And I love the way this artist pictures Jesus, because it almost looks like what? Doesn't it? You know, so here's Jesus standing with the sinners getting washed, and he doesn't have any sins. Except Jesus has got all the sin of all the world that's on him. It's going to drown him. It's going to kill him. His baptism in water sets up his baptism in blood. Deliberately, Jesus knows what he's doing. So I like the way our baptism, this article remembers us, Jesus went down all the way for our sake. And it's not the end of the story. You can also see this thing and you can wonder if in fact Jesus is coming up. He's about to lift his hands and his head and say, I love you. That's what it's all about. The risen one. I love you. You are precious. You are mine. Now I know, baptized brothers and sisters, that at times you will feel that this old wicked world and even friends in the church have pierced you. And that is part of our story, being joined to Jesus. He didn't promise it would be easy when he said, take up your cross. It's part of the ritual. We walk sometimes a hard road too. But that's not where the road ends. It's not the end of the story. The risen one loves us. the risen one baptized you by name. The risen one.
For you. Amen. We're going to turn in our bulletin then to page 8 next, standing in a moment for prayer. Not yet, because I want to give you a chance to let you know if there are other prayers that you'd like to add. I'm asking you to take this paper home, please, because you'll find on the very back page the list of people that I'm going to mention here that are looking for prayer. And the one update, since we printed this thing, that I need to give to you is we had noted there for you that Norma Remke indeed was called home on January 13, but we do not have printed there that the memorial for Norma is this Thursday, the 20th, here at church at 3 o'clock. So Thursday at 3 o'clock for family and friends and church family of Norma. Also had a special prayer from Dwayne Gerstenberger this morning as he's doing some doctoring and praying for a good result for some tests. Are there other prayers that you want to add this morning? I didn't even look up birthdays yet today. Anybody got a birthday today or a celebration or a prayer for healing? Any other special prayers? You're all prayed up. Wonderful to have guests among us. Please.
Prayer for blessings on our youth gathering Thursday evening.
Yeah, and we got some youth gathering together on Thursday. We're asking God's blessing on that. Trying to regather our Sunday schoolers and some others. Yep. Other prayers? Please, Ken.
Pray for Ed and Carol Hill.
Ed and Carol. Is that a prayer for healing? Let's turn to page 8 and stand with our prayers. We'll be following the service up from that point. Oh, Almighty God, you make light to shine out of darkness, new life to spring out of old, a new people out of sinners, redeemed by Christ. We are grateful that you have given to your church the wonderful gift, the baptism by which you make us members of your family, heirs of life that never ends. Guide your worldwide church and this, your family of Concordia.
Move your baptized people to grow in faith and to be your God of life, pleasing to you.
O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as you are one, so make us one in you. Help your church to show this harmony in all you give us to do.
Be all your people as you shine the light of your love.
Lord God, be with all who are in need. We remember those who turn to you for healing, including Luke, Richard, Shirley, Richard, Eric, Joe and Kim, Rob, Darren, Tom, Nancy, Susie, Myers, Cheryl and Carla, Dwayne, Ed and Carol. We ask your blessing, Lord, on those who are grieving, that you would come for the family and friends of Norma. Come, Lord, for the family of Scott Leanne's cousin. For all of us, Lord, in our griefs, come with your Holy Spirit's comfort. Strengthen us on our journey, Lord, and gather the little ones again to yourself at Concordia. Asking your blessing on Thursday and opportunities you give to us to share your love with this and with all generations. Lord God, give to them your comfort and healing. Give to us boldness to proclaim Christ's good news to our neighbors. Through your Spirit's leading, grant that your church baptize and teach in your name.
So send us to carry out your mission.
Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray.
We trust in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the Lord be with you now. self-giving, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. We praise you that you did send to us your only begotten Son, and that in him, our true brother, you show to the world the fullness of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all those in heaven, we too evermore praise you and sing. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying,
"Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, Jesus also took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave that to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you.
Thank you. by his blood, God's himself, fill you up. All of his love, you have been baptized, Son and daughter, go with him.
Thank you.
turn, if you'd like, with me to page 10 and stand. Actually, all you get to say is amen. I believe it. What amen means. Page 12. I'm putting my glasses on. There we go. My broken glasses. God is so good. Let's give him thanks. As we do give you thanks, O Lord, for the body and blood of your Son, Jesus, given for our forgiveness, so we give you thanks, Almighty God, that in the waters of the Jordan, Jesus began his earthly work of redeeming us. As he has chosen to meet us in baptism's life-giving waters, so give to us your Holy Spirit that we may recognize his presence, believe in him with all our hearts and minds, and serve him in newness of life all our days. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you, be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you